house of the Lord. We hope you've had a wonderful day. And every day's wonderful, Lord's in it, amen? And he ought to be a part of every day, every night, every passing moment. We owe everything to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we're looking forward here in a little while. Brother Johnny Moses is going to be coming with our special music. So you pray for Johnny as he comes to sing here in a little bit. Let's remember all of, I'm going to go ahead and make some of our announcements. Let's do remember May the 27th, mark this down at 6 p.m. We need several volunteers to come and help clean the fellowship hall for homecoming. If you can help, there's a sign-up sheet in the front foyer. You can put your John Hancock there, all right? And anybody know why they use John Hancock? You know, he signed the Declaration of Independence. And I think he signed his name bigger than everybody on that document. And so that became a popular saying, sign your John Hancock. Anybody ever read about that in history? They did used to teach history in our schools. They really did. They're not teaching a whole lot of anything now. But anyway, contrary to what the revisionist historians will tell you, America is an exceptional nation, and we owe our existence to God. And don't let nobody tell you we don't. We do, thank God. And there's still a lot of people in this country that love Jesus. Amen? But thank the Lord that we live in this great country. June the 6th, homecoming, Phillips and Banks will be here with us. That's on a Sunday morning. I'll be here in a couple of weeks. And we'll be providing the church will a fellowship meal. And all we're asking each family to bring is a dessert, pre-sliced, canned drink, or individual plastic drinks. No 2-liter drinks. So do remember that. And then our men's prayer fellowship, June the 12th, at 9:30 a.m. in the church fellowship hall. Well, we do want to go to the Lord in prayer. Does anybody have any spoken requests at this time? All right, amen. Let's remember that. Those requests? Yes. All right, let's remember these requests. Anybody else? Oh, boy. Yes. Yes. Oh, boy. Yes. Yes. Let's pray for Sister Cindy Lane. Is it tomorrow, Kathy? June 1st, she's going to have her gallbladder taken out, correct? So let's pray for Sister Cindy. Yes, amen. Mrs. Cress, right? Let's pray for Sister Cress. Continue to pray for Sister Joy, amen. Lift her up to the Lord. You start the treatments this week, right, Joy? Tuesday. So let's really be lifting her up to the Lord in her prayers. Amen. Yes. Amen. And also remember Brother Bob Lane. He's still having some issues with his neck. So remember Brother Bob in your prayers. Amen. Oh, yeah. I remember we were having pictures or we were doing something here at the church. And there was this guy, his, I guess, vehicle had broken down. He needed some help. And he was homeless. And I remember Brother Tom Turner was here, and I asked Tom to ride with me, and we took that young man back to where he lived. And it was down by the river. He's living in an old tent. And, of course, we talked to him about the Lord. There's a lot of people, you know, are really struggling. And we need to not forget them. And I know some have got themselves there by their lifestyle, but others, you know, hard workers, they just had some bad breaks in life. And but I'll never forget taking that man. And we let him out, and he had a little tent down there at the river. That really shook me up. Be thankful for what you have, amen. I mean, I'm thankful to God because, we're going to leave it all, but boy, hadn't God richly blessed us. Amen. Thank God. Yes, this member, Sister Joel, she is back home, but continue to pray for her and Brother Vernon. Precious, precious people. Any others? Yes. Yes. Amen. Yep. Any others? Brother Steve.
Remember the good people that know their reports, Christian ministries. They are going to have camp this year, and they help a tremendous amount of young people.
Yes.
And we're blessed to go help them and work on the roads and stuff. And it is it's a really wonderful thing.
Amen. Yes, amen. Sure is. I believe that's where our young people are going to go. We're going to have it's a short camp, but I think they're going to go up to Doe River. All right. Any others? Yes. All right. All right. Let's remember Christopher. Has to have him all right done. Anybody else? Yes. Amen. Amen. Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Amen. Let's pray for each other. Brother Rex and I were talking before service. A lot of churches are struggling. And, you know, but I praise God. We know the church will always exist. The true church. How many knows that? The devil can fight it all he wants to. But the church of Jesus Christ will never be annihilated. I'm glad I belong to his family, aren't you? Now, we may see some rough times, and we've seen it, but, you know, it's sort of like the Egyptians. When they, the more they fought and the more that they made it so much harder on the Israelites, guess what? God just kept blessing them, didn't he? And they kept growing. You've heard the old saying, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. And over in China, in that communistic country, they're having to meet underground, but there's a mighty move of God over there in China. Wouldn't you like to see a mighty move of God again in America? Hey, let me tell you, the Lord hadn't changed. His word hadn't changed. He's still the same. We can always rely on him. But wouldn't you like to see a mighty revival just sweep across this area? And let's... Hey, the way things are going in the world, I think we're really close to the rapture. I really believe that. I keep my eye on what's going on in Israel. They're being attacked on every end. Hey, that's another people that's going to be around according to the Bible. Amen? And the Bible says in the last days they'll turn back to the Lord. That's what the Scripture says. I believe what this book says. They'll have to come to Jesus just like we have, but God made a promise to Abraham, and how many knows that's still good today? He said, I'll bless them that bless you, I'll curse them that curse you. I'm going to tell you why, I don't want to get political here, but I'm going to tell you why our administration's struggling. They're not being a friend to Israel. We better never turn our back on Israel, amen? Hallelujah. But we know Russia has a part in the end times. And then, of course, Iran is Persia. They'll have a part in the end times. And then many believe what that great big army is going to be from China. So, I think I'm like that old brother. He was talking. He said, I believe the Lord's coming is so close. He said, I've quit looking for the signs. And he said, I've started listening for the trumpet to sound. Amen. Amen. We're running that time, church. We need to do all we can, don't we, to lead the lost to Jesus Christ. Let's pray for our country. Boy, wouldn't you love to be in a movement of God when Jesus comes back? Wouldn't that be something? Hallelujah. That just excites me to think about it. But you know what? We got a lot of people, they want a convenient religion. I better be careful. I feel like I'm ready to cut loose right here. But they want the Lord at their convenience. And my friend, that's not how we're to serve the Lord. Sometimes it'll be inconvenient for you, but it's better than your convenience. Anything you do for Jesus, you'll never regret. But you'll regret a lot of things you did for yourself. But you won't for Jesus. Amen. How about the unspoken request? I better go ahead and take prayer requests. I'm ready to preach. Help us, Lord. Amen. Everybody can and will, let's gather around the altar this evening. Let's get a hold of the horns of the altar of God. Let's cry out unto our Lord. Let's ask Him to come down among us. Amen. Appreciate the young man that got right with the Lord this morning. CJ, isn't it wonderful people can come to your church and feel the Spirit and be drawn by God? CJ hadn't been living here long. He's moved up from Alabama. And I think Rick and Teresa were changing the sign. He came out and started talking to them. And then he came here today. Say he's going to bring his family with him. So let's remember that young man in our prayers. Yes. Amen. Little Austin. Yeah, he got his surgery. They're scheduled to have it this week, but his surgeon had a family member pass. Not going to be able to do it. So please pray for pray for Austin. Yes. All right. Remember Sister Louise? Yes. Amen. Fred and Rachel, lift them up to the Lord. Any others? Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Brother X Johnson, it's good to have you and Sister Pam with us here tonight. Would you lead us to the Lord in prayer, please?
About his knees pop when you just got it. Oh my goodness. Yeah, who's dead? Yeah, that's right. Them chickens have come to roost, haven't they? It's all that ball playing I did growing up. I know.
And I thank God I can still get up.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Johnny, come sing. Appreciate Brother Johnny. Amen.
Appreciate the Lord. Thank Him for saving me. And Lord placed this song here. Didn't know what to sing. And He placed this song on my heart. Many people, I believe, have sang it here. I've sung it a few times. Brother Joel sang it. Andrea, maybe Bridget, I'm not sure. But just listen to the words of it. We all need the Lord. And I just thank Him for salvation.
Thank you, Lord.
We are.
the Lord. We all do, don't we? My. Open your Bibles with me to Daniel. Lord's had Brother Daniel on my heart. Daniel chapter 1. Daniel chapter 1. I'm going to read probably the first about 9 verses, 10 verses. Would you stand, please, everyone that's able, in reverence to God's holy word? Imagine being taken into captivity, being hauled off from a way of life that you've known. Many believe that Daniel, when he and the others were taken in captivity here, that he was somewhere between, some have said 14 years old, some said 16, so somewhere between 14 and 16 years of age. But you know, he must have had righteous parents and brought up right, because he had some convictions. I wouldn't give you a plug nickel for a man or a woman don't have some convictions, amen? From the word of God, of course. We'll begin reading verse number 1, Daniel chapter 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. Now notice this, and the Lord gave, look at that. God is judging his people. He gave them opportunity to turn to him. They kept pushing him away. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand. He wouldn't have taken over the king of Judah if God hadn't have let it happen and allowed it to happen. Amen? All right, just I want you to take note of that. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed, and of the princes. So we see here, David must have had royal blood in him. And he must have been a very smart young man. Verse number 4 says, children in whom was no blemish, but well-favored, handsome, good-looking, is what that means, and skillful in all wisdom, and cunning in knowledge, and understanding science, and such as had ability in them. Praise God, aren't you glad God sees ability in you? Others may see disability. God sees ability. Hallelujah. And such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat, or food, and of the wine which he drank. So nourishing them 3 years, this was a course of 3 years, a time of training, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. That word stand literally means serve. All right? We need to serve the king. Now among these were of the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and unto Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. Every time I read about Abednego, I think of the preacher. He didn't speak real clearly, and he was talking about Shadrach, Meshach, and then he come to Abednego, but he didn't say Abednego. He said, and to bed we go. Amen. But Daniel, read this with me. Let's read it out loud. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now, God had brought Daniel into favor. Oh, I love that. God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who have appointed your meat and your drink, for why should he see your faces worse likened than the children which are of your sort? Then shall ye make me to endanger my head to the king. He said, I don't want to be hung. Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your precious word. I ask now that you would anoint me with the Holy Spirit. Help me, Lord, to remember that I've studied, and we just want to rightly divide thy word of truth and be a blessing to our brothers and sisters in Christ and an encouragement. May you get all the glory and all the praise from this message. Meet the needs of each and every heart. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Daniel's life and ministry bridged the entire 70-year period of Babylonian captivity. Deported to Babylon at the age of around 16 and handpicked for government service, Daniel becomes God's prophetic mouthpiece to the Gentile and Jewish world, declaring God's present and eternal purpose. Nine of the 12 chapters in his book revolve around dreams, including God-given visions involving trees, animals, beasts, and images. In both his personal adventures and prophetic visions, Daniel shows God's guidance. Aren't you thankful? We have God's guidance. God's intervention. Thank God. Do you need divine intervention? God can break through. If you need a breakthrough tonight, I serve a God of breakthrough. Some things you and I may not be able to break through, but there's nothing that God can't break through. And that's where our trust and our faith needs to be. So Daniel shows God's guidance, his intervention, but also his power in the affairs of humanity. Daniel's name literally means God is my judge. Of course, Dan was one of the 12 sons of Jacob, one of the tribes of Israel. The book of Daniel has been cast into the critics' den by many. That like Daniel, they try to put it down. But thank God, this book is God's book. It's inspired of God. And just as Daniel escaped from the mouth of the lions, all these critics, they can have their criticism. But the book of Daniel is still here. A lot of prophecy in Daniel's been fulfilled, but there's still quite a bit of it that is yet to be fulfilled. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ approved of it. Remember he talked about the abomination of desolation that you read about in the prophet Daniel. So Jesus approved of it. And we know that it formed part of the canonical scriptures in our Lord's time. The great man Sir Isaac Newton said about this book, Christianity itself may be said to be founded on the prophecies of Daniel. Yes, you can read about the Messiah, the Lord Jesus Christ, in the book of Daniel. After the siege of Jerusalem, Daniel had been taken captive to Babylon. That would have been a distance of around 800 miles from Jerusalem. Like we said earlier, he's probably around the age of 14. Some think he was around 16. It would have been so easy for Daniel to cave in, for Daniel to compromise. He was in a strange and a far-off land. But Daniel never forgot his upbringing. And I believe with all my heart, even though we don't know who his parents were and how they brought him up, I believe they brought him upright. I believe they trained him in the law of God. And that he knew about God, that he knew of God, the commandments of God, Daniel remained true to God. And my friend, that's what we need to do in these last days before our Savior and our Lord returns for his triumphant church. We just need to remain steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. Let them laugh at us. Let them prosecute us. Let them persecute us. But the church is going on. And someday, thank God, I believe before too long, the church is going up past the Milky Way. We're going past the moon and the sun. And we're going to be in heaven with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's be true to God. Others may be compromising. Let's not compromise. Let's stand true. Let's be men and women of purpose as Daniel was. I want you to look with me at a few things about Daniel here. The first thing, notice his character. We don't know who his daddy and mama were, But judging from his character just as a young man, he must have been nurtured in a God-fearing home. How many is glad you were nurtured in a God-fearing home? It's untelling where you and I would be this very moment if we hadn't had godly Christian parents that prayed with us, that read the Word of God to us, that required us to obey them. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. That's the one commandment that's got a promise attached to it, that your days upon the earth may be long. Yes, my friends, we are obligated to obey our mama and our dads. But we know, you might, as the old saying goes, you might take the boy out of the country, but you can't take the country out of the boy. What Daniel learned and what Daniel was taught was a big part of his life. And even though he was away from everything that he knew as home, he wasn't away from God. God's eyes were still upon him. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but I want you to hear what thus saith the Lord. You may not have a lot of recognition from other people. You may feel like no one cares for you. But I want you to know, if you belong to Jesus, he has you in his eyes and in his thoughts and in his purpose. And he's using you. And don't let the devil tell you that God's not using you. And God's people said, yes, these soundest of the principles of life had been early formed in Daniel. Someone said there's nothing rarer than personality, for there's so many causes that hinder both interior and exterior, so many hostile forces to crush, so many illusions to lead astray. But blessed is that young man, that young woman, who can truly say, I know in whom I have believed, and he is able to keep that I've committed unto him against that day. Beloved, it's not time for us to panic. It's not time for us to throw up our hands and say, I quit. It's time for us to roll up our sleeves and roll up our britchy legs and get to work in the service of the Lord, because the King is coming soon and we need to be found like Jesus was found. You remember that Joseph and Mary had left him. He was a little 12-year-old boy. They had left him at the temple. He was confounding the doctors and the lawyers, and they had been gone for a few days. They realized Jesus wasn't with them, and so they went back to Jerusalem and they found him in the temple, and he was talking with the doctors and the lawyers, and of course they let him know, son, we've been worried to death over you. And Jesus said, wished you not that I must be about my Father's business. Yes, my friend, we need to be like our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We need to be about our Father's business, because the Bible tells us, redeeming the time because the days are evil. And if we ever need more men and women of character, it is today in this world in which we live. Yes, God's people, that should be a trait of you and me, that we are men and women of a good, strong character. All right. So we know, thank God, his character was right. He stood true to the test in his life. He was a man of purpose. We see his character. Secondly, notice his temptations. Yes, my friend, the trial of your faith is more precious than gold that perisheth. If our faith is never tried, it'd never grow. You want greater faith, you're going to have greater trials. You want God to use you in a greater way, you're going to be more greatly persecuted. You're going to suffer. Oh, but if we suffer with him, we shall also reign with him. I know things are not looking that good right now. As you look around, our gas prices have been jacked up. Our grocery items, they've been jacked up. But I'm glad, thank God, that eternal life is free. But it cost our Lord everything. It cost him his life. He shed his precious blood. And my friend, anything less than your all and my all to him is unacceptable in the sight of God. Yes, we'll be tested. These are needed for our moral and our spiritual development. The king had a command. There was blameless youth. They were skillful. They were wise. I don't think they had tested them for their IQ back then. Probably didn't know what IQ was. But they were very intelligent. They were exceptional young men. They were trustworthy, and they were being prepared to serve the King. Yes, my friend, that's what you and I are doing. We're being prepared, and we should prepare to serve our Lord and Savior and our King, Jesus Christ. So we see here, they took the honored place of students at the Royal College, and it was their responsibility to stand in the King's palace. They took a 3-year course, and what they were taught is to learn the language, the tongue, the philosophy, the knowledge of the Chaldeans. They were politicians, philosophers, theologians, and teachers of the nation. What an opportunity for a young, bright, hopeful man. But thank God, Daniel was a man of principle. He had convictions. Amen. I believe our country is suffering greatly today because a lot of folk that's trying to serve us and lead us, they have no convictions. If they have a conviction, it's their own. If they have a standard, it's not the Bible standards. It's their own man-made standards. My friend, man-made religion will send you to hell. You must be born again. You must be right with God. Anybody glad you come to church? Boy, I tell you, I'm challenged every time I read about Daniel. When I read about Elijah or Elisha. When I read about, I know our Sunday school curriculum. Sister Kathy's telling me about it, Brother Wes, how they've been enjoying studying and been studying on the life of Joseph in the Old Testament. My, he was almost a perfect type of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He was betrayed by his brothers. Jesus was betrayed by Judas Iscariot. Oh, but listen, he stood true. And my friend, because he was true and he is true, you and I can be true and you and I can stand the test of time. Amen. So we see here the opportunities were before him, but there were some problems. The king had assigned a portion of meat, or that word meat there, it doesn't just, we literally think of meat, we think about a T-bone or a ribeye. Yeah. And of course, if it had been pork, Jews were forbidden to eat the pork. I remember I had a friend at Maryville College in the dorm. He lived close to me. He was a Muslim, and I was probably a little bit hard on him, but I remember we'd go to the cafeteria and eat. And at college, how many members, we used to have a meat, we called it mystery meat. We didn't know what it was. Hey, if I don't know what something is, I don't think I'm going to eat it. I remember some of these old preachers telling me they would go way off from here. Brother Rex probably heard some of these stories as well. Some of these older men of God, they'd go places and they said, so help me. The places was, they said, infested with fleas and it was dirty. And they were thankful to be there. Didn't think they were too good to be there, but they said, thank God for hot coffee. Brother Stokes told me, he said that he looked at something, he'd just stick it in his mouth, get him that coffee, and wash that down with that good, strong coffee. Amen. Amen. Well, I'm not going to stay there because I could tell you some stories about myself, but I'm not going there. I'll tell you this. I know there's been times we've went to homes, bless Sister Kathy's heart, and they want to push something off on me, and if I don't like it, I said, Sister Kathy will take it. Amen. But they say as you get older, your taste changes, and I can vouch for that. But there's just some things. God bless you. I love you. But if there's some things I don't like and you make it, don't get offended at me. I just don't like it. You don't want me to get sick, do you? But anyway, I know we should thank God for whatever God gives us. Amen. And I don't have to worry about that. We got a bunch of good cooks. But you see, Daniel had a question. Let me get back to a hobbit. We were in a cafeteria, and of course, you know, a Muslim, they can't eat pork either. And man, he was just all upset and nervous about it. He had the meat in his plate, and he said, I just wonder if this is pork. I don't know. He's from Egypt, by the way. And I said, Ahmed, let me tell you something. Become a Christian, and you eat all the pork you want. You don't have to worry about it. I was a little mean. I shouldn't have said that to him. But I said, if you're a Christian, you can eat any meat. But I tried to lead him to the Lord. I never was successful, but I'll never forget that. But that was his conviction. Listen, we need to have convictions, but let it be biblical convictions. If the Bible says don't do it, you better not do it. If the Bible says do it, by all means, obey the word of God. Daniel could have come to his mind, well, I'm here and nobody will notice it. All my others that's with us, the other Jewish people, they don't have an issue with it. This is how the devil works. Don't let him bargain with you. Don't have a conversation with him. Don't let nobody fool you. He knows the Bible. He tried to twist it and turn it on Jesus, but Jesus knew the Bible better than him. Amen. You know what a lot of Christians' problems are? They don't know their Bible. We need to get in this book. We need to get in it so much that it gets in us. Amen. And we follow it. We obey it. We practice it. But anyway, Daniel didn't cave in. He stood true to God, and God blessed him. Yes, my friend, he couldn't eat that meat and drink that wine because it had been consecrated to idols and it would defile his conscience. You see, the worldly man or woman, they see no difficulty, but rather a grand chance to attain honor and earthly glory. But it's very different with the man or woman who is abiding in the fellowship of God. Daniel's relationship meant more to him than a piece of meat or food that had been consecrated to the idols. His relationship with the Lord, it meant more to him than drinking strong, intoxicating beverages. And therefore, he was true to God and to the Word of God. And my friend, that's why it doesn't surprise me here that the Bible said that God showed favor that Daniel, the man that was put over him, God showed favor. God brought Daniel into favor. Amen. I love that. But before that, let's not get ahead of ourselves. Daniel was true to God. Daniel wanted to do the will of God. Daniel was a man of principle and conviction. And so he had made up in his heart, I'm not going to eat the king's meat. I'm not going to drink the king's wine. And therefore he made a request. And there the story, they had the contest. He said, just give us pulse, that's vegetables, some type of pottage. And then he said, give us water to drink. And we know that this contest was done for 10 days. Listen, aren't you glad that God's food is superior to the devil's food? You won't get sick on God's diet. You'll get sick on the devil's diet and what the world has to offer. Oh my, thank God Daniel purposed in his heart. Look at that. That's the third thing I want you to see with me. He purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself. This in our days would be called narrow-mindedness or bigotry. If you've got any standards, you're the one they look. They look at us as being crazy now. People's running our country. I got news for them. Hey, I'm crazy for Jesus. I'm going to follow the Word of God. I don't want to go against the law of God. I don't want to go against the teachings of the Holy Scriptures. This is how strong I believe it. If we go against God's word, we're going against God himself, because he's the one that has given it to us. We'll never go wrong following the word of God. And God's people said, look at Brother Paul. What great advice Paul said in Romans chapter 14 and verse number 21. He said, it's good neither to eat flesh nor to drink wine nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth, or is offended, or is made weak. That man is of little value for God, who's not able to stand against popular opinion. I know what I'm talking about firsthand. I lived a sheltered life up in Old Kill in the mountains and the hills there. Thank God us boys were brought up in the ways of the Lord. But when I went off to college, oh, I tell you, my faith was put to the test. The friends that they did not understand me, I was weird to them because they were out partying. They were out doing all types of ungodliness and vile living, and they would just laugh at me. I remember one time a guy saying to me, they like to call me Street. Dad, I don't know if they called you that a lot, Street. They'd call me street. They'd say, street, you're never going to find a woman if you don't go looking for one. And I'd tell him, I say, listen, I don't want to find a woman where you're finding them at, in the bars and the honky-tonks. I said, God will send me a woman. Amen. If it's the Lord's will. How many knows it pays to wait on the Lord? We said that this morning. Oh my, yes, let's stand on the word of God. Yes, we know the Talmud, it's a Jewish writing, said this, a myrtle tree remains a myrtle even in the desert. Yes, they would look at me. I remember one guy telling me, he said, you live like they did in Bible days. He's actually paying me a compliment right there. Amen. God has a witness. Listen, have you ever stopped to think? I know there's been places where you were employed and you worked and you had a hard time. But you know what? If that's where God wants you, that's where He wants you to be, so you can be a light for Jesus. You can be a testimony for Jesus. People that work around you know what type of person you are. Oh, they may brush shoulders with you. They may backbite you, stab you in the back. They may tell lies on you, but I tell you, if you're living that true life in front of them, you're being a Christian, I guarantee you that God is using you for His glory. And don't let that old devil tell you that your life is in vain. We need more Christians with principled convictions serving us in our public arena, serving us in our local and our state and our federal government. We just need more Christians getting involved. We're awful bad about criticizing all the bad that's been going on. But what have you and I done to keep the bad from going on? Well, how are you and I living our life? You say, preacher, people don't want to hear that. Listen, that's what people need to hear. They need to hear the word of God. Yes, a man of God should act as such in any circumstance. Wherever you may be in life, wherever I may be in life, let's be true to the Scriptures. Let's be true to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Yes, my friend, God's not influenced by man-made conditions. There was a lad of 15 years. He was following the plow near the Carse of Galric. The horses stopped in the middle of the furrow. And in that moment, this question came to his mind. Might I not make more of my life than I'm doing? And straightening himself up, he said, God helping me, I will be a missionary. And that lad's name was Dr. James Stewart of Lovedale. Yes, friends, we need to be like Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. We need to keep a conscience that's void of offense. All right, we've seen in this man of purpose, his character, his temptations, his purpose. But fourthly, notice with me, his reward. Amen. God made Daniel to find favor. There was a great crisis in the life of Daniel. Who knows? Thank God he stood the test and he was true to his God. Who knows if Daniel had failed here, we might have never heard from him again. But Daniel was not going to fail because God hadn't failed him. Even though he was in a strange land, even though he had been hauled off there, I'm sure not by his own will and his own desire. But thank God, you see the turning point and what caused things to happen the way they did for Daniel was this. Yes, Daniel was taken from his people, but his God was not taken from him. His God was with him wherever he went. How many knows your Lord is with you? My Lord is with me. Wherever we may go, and you may go into some dark places in life, but I'm glad that the darkness can't keep the light from shining. And if we ever needed the brightness of the gospel of Jesus Christ to shine more, it's in the day in which we live. Let's not give up, church, because soon and very soon we're going to be with the King. Hallelujah. Anybody tired of this old world down here? Oh, I'm longing to go be with Jesus. And God's people said, yes, Daniel was found faithful. Amen. And God promoted him. Amen. God promoted him. Henceforth, he's marked as a leader of the people. You see, he had faith in God. And it was true to God in his convictions. And it got him the victory for both his body and his soul. Because at the end of those 10 days, the Bible tells us that Daniel and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, that their flesh was fatter, that they looked healthier, that they looked better. How many knows it's better with Jesus? Oh, I know people give you a hard time, but it's still better with Jesus. People will talk behind your back. They'll laugh at you. They'll ridicule you. But it's better with Jesus. They'll separate themselves from you. They'll look down on you. But it's better with Jesus. Hallelujah. Listen, friend, we're not in a sprint. We're in a marathon. But I believe the finish line is just in sight. And we will be with our Lord. So let's not quit. Let's keep going for Jesus. Amen. Yes, the Bible tells us their countenances were fair and fatter than all who did eat of the king's meat. Yes, godliness is profitable. Why? Because it's the highest type of character and the best possible relationship to God and men. The wisdom that profited Daniel was not found in the schools of the learned, but in the closet of the communion with his God, the God of heaven. Amen. Determined, you and I need to be like Paul. We need to determine to know nothing among men save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And the wisdom of God will be in you and me. Boy, let's take courage. There's an old song. I don't know if it's in our hymn books or not. But the title of that song, Dare to Be a Daniel. Yes, boy, we need to dare to be a Daniel. Listen, too many Christians are fitting too comfortably in the world. Can't tell a difference. My Bible says you can tell a difference between a child of God and a child of Satan. There's a difference. As much as the difference is from dark to light. Thank God we're not in the dark. Hallelujah. I know it's sort of been a dark, sort of a cloudy type of day. But thank God, don't let it get you down. The sun's going to break through real soon. Oh, let me tell you, let's not let the activities and all that's been going on these last several months to defeat us. Because thank God, the capital S-O-N, the Son of God, is breaking through. Amen. And he's going to break through someday the sky. And he's coming to get us out of this world. Hallelujah. Let's be true to Jesus. Amen. And God will bless us. Let's stand to our feet. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Sister Diane, could you come to the piano? Brother Dave, come with a song. Get a song. I just feel impressed to do this tonight. I hope you've been blessed. My, my. I'm always challenged when I study about Daniel. My. Boy, it's just convenient, isn't it? Just to go with the flow. Go with the crowd. But my friend, don't go with the crowd. Unless that crowd's Christians that love Jesus. But a lot of people don't love Jesus today. My, my, my. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Would there be somebody here this evening say, boy, preacher, I've really, really had some trying days and times. I need God's help. I need God's guidance. I need God's grace and strength. It's just been a hard time for me lately. Would you and my brothers and sisters in Christ pray for me? Would you pray for me? Would you just slip your hand up? Say, please pray for me. God knows what it's all about, but I'm believing God. Because I know God can intervene. God knows what it's about. Would you raise your hand and say, please pray? God knows. You need a breakthrough. Amen. We serve a God of breakthroughs. Would you raise your hand and say, I need something. Preacher, will you and my brothers and sisters in Christ pray for me? Anybody at all? Anybody at all? How many know someone, or maybe more than one, that needs a breakthrough, and only God can break them through? Amen. Only God can bring them deliverance and victory. Several hands raised. Need to be prayer. Amen. Pray for them. Pray for them. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Anybody else here tonight? We're going to pray and we're going to sing and give the invitation. Anybody else here tonight? I might not have touched on what your need is, but you have a need. You need something special from God tonight, and you know the Lord can provide it. Would you raise your hand and say, please pray for me? God knows what it is. Will you remember me in prayer? Anybody at all? I need something from the Lord. I see that hand right there. Yes, God bless you. I see that hand. God bless you. Anybody else? Yes, I see that hand. Anybody else? Yes, amen, amen. Anybody else? Pray for me. God knows what it's all about. Anybody else? Will you pray with me? Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for your holy word. Thank you, Lord, how that you were with Daniel. And Lord, we in the day and time we're living, we feel like Daniel many a time. But I know, God, that you're real. I know, God, that you've brought us this far. And Lord, that you're going to go with us all the way. Several raised their hand, Lord, that said they know individuals that need a breakthrough. Lord, they need a miracle. Lord, they need to get right with you. Or they need something that only you can provide. And then others, Lord, said they had special needs. God, help them to step out from that pew, make their way up here to this old-fashioned altar, and get the help that they need. We love you, Lord. We thank you for your word. Help us, Lord, to be true. Help us, Lord, to shine brighter and brighter for you. We love you. Have your way in this service. And we'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name, amen. As we sing, you need to use this altar. Come on, right now. Come on. I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou biddest me come to thee, O Lamb of God. Sing another verse, please, Brother Dave. As I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blood to thee. Amen. Blood can cleanse each spot. Thank you all so very much. Let's stick with the Word of God. Amen. Do what the Bible tells us to do. And God will bless. Brother Johnny Mosier, would you dismiss us in prayer, please? Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Yes.